Hello, and welcome to 5 Minutes of Postgres. My name is Lucas, and today we're going to talk about when to lower random page cost and how it's used inside the Postgres planner. We'll start with this blog post by Shayon Mukherjee on his personal blog. In this post, Shayon describes a particular situation that they encountered on their production system where they were optimizing queries, and they were able to achieve 100 times faster queries by tuning the random page cost setting. Many of you, I'm sure, have actually tuned this before, because in most environments that I have seen where the default of random page cost 4 is being used, it actually does make sense to lower that to a lower setting. But today I want to dive a little bit more into the specific situation that Shayon encountered, because I think it is actually something that's a little bit more puzzling than the usual situation. And then I also want to take a look at how the Postgres planner uses these cost settings and how we can reason about adjusting them. Let's look a little bit closer at the situation at hand. So Shayon was comparing two different query plans. You can see here in this example, we have a nested loop joined between two tables. The first table just returns two rows, and the second table has a limit 500, and we're getting 500 rows from that second table. But there might be more matching the condition. Now, the current index that's being used is the primary key index on that second table. The starting point here is that we're seeing 11 seconds of runtime. If you look at this plan, one thing that you would probably be noticing is that there is a lot of rows removed by filter. So even though we're doing an index scan, we're seeing that the index scan doesn't reduce down based on a particular index condition. The where clause isn't really being used here. Instead, the index is being used for its ordering. So the index is being used for the fact that it returns the primary key in order. And then Postgres can use that to essentially load the data successfully from the main table. Now, the other thing I want to mention here is that we can see how Postgres estimated the cost for this. And so Postgres, if we were to retrieve all the data, estimated that we'd have cost 20,000 here. But because we had this limit, it only estimated a cost of 35 for each of those two loops. So you can think of the total cost for that side of the loop would be roughly 70 cost units. Let's look at what the change to random page cost did. So Shayon changed the random page cost from the default of 4 cost units to be 1.1 cost units. And this actually changed the plan quite significantly, because first of all, on that first table where previously we were getting a sequential scan, now we're getting an index-only scan. That doesn't actually make the difference in this example. It's nice to see an index-only scan, but that doesn't really benefit us much here. It's really that second table where we're now seeing that instead of using the primary key index, it's using an index where it matches the where condition. And through that, it's able to use the index to look up everything. And so you can see in the second table, it's able to use the index to filter down on the index entries that are only relevant for the particular IDs we're looking for, and that match that completed is null condition. Now, what does that actually mean? Why did Postgres change its query plan here based on us adjusting this random page cost setting? So first of all, the Postgres documentation has a good explanation on the cost units. Before we dive into how the random page cost setting works, I want to make sure that you understand how these cost units work. So when we have a plan, we can look at the size of this table, and we can see this table has 10,000 rows, hence this estimate here of returning 10,000 rows, and then it has 358 disk pages. Now the math here for a sequential scan is fairly simple. Postgres will say how many disk pages do I have to read. It will multiply that by the sequential page cost, which is used for sequential scans. And then we'll also add a little bit of a CPU tuple cost. Now, if we look at the Postgres source, when a planner comes with different alternate plans, it will call the functions in costsize.c in order to estimate how much cost a particular scan will take. So here we can see in the cost index function, amongst other things, what the planner will do is it will actually delegate this decision to the particular index access method. So most of the time in Postgres, you'll have a B-tree index, but if you have a JIN index, for example, it has a very different cost pattern than a B-tree, than a hash, and such. And so it's good to know that just because something is true for B-tree doesn't mean it's true for other index types. Now, if we look at the BT cost estimate function, you can see that this will do certain things that are very specific to B-trees. So for example, with B-trees, only leading equality comparisons impact how much of the index we're scanning. Now, ultimately, what this ends up doing is it ends up calling this generic cost estimate function. And it passes in the number of index tuples, aka index entries, that Postgres thinks it will have to read. And so if we look through here, in the simplest case, what it actually does for an index scan is literally just saying number of index entries we'll have to get times the random page cost. So this is fairly straightforward. A lower random page cost setting here means that for the same amount of index pages, the index cost will get lower. But now the real question is, if this random page cost here is essentially the same for each index, why did we get the choice of one index in Shayon's plan with random page cost 4 and a choice of another index with page cost 1.1? I'm guessing a little bit here because I don't have access to the original system, but I think it actually comes down to the fact that Postgres thought that the index result was correlated with the table and would be able to end the scan early because it thought it would match more conditions through looking at the table for the matching IDs. You can see that the cost index function at the later parts of the function actually tries to estimate how many of the main table pages, not the index pages, how many of the main table pages it will have to fetch. And you can see here, it will actually take into account the sequential page cost, not just the random page cost. And so if Postgres estimates that you have correlation between the index result and the table, it might think that if the difference between random page cost and sequential page cost is large, it might make more sense to essentially scan the index and then scan the table versus relying on the index to get that result. And so I think really this comes down to Postgres incorrectly thinking that it doesn't have to look at 150,000 rows to be able to get the matching result. Thought it would have to get a lot less rows from the main table to be able to fulfill that limit 500 that was being asked for. And so I think it's a bit hard to reason about, but what I'd probably do is if I was in the situation, besides testing random page cost, I would also try to understand what are the actual cost units. If you don't change the random page cost, you use something like pghintplan to get the better plan which you think it should be using. What is this cost value here that Postgres is estimating? And also how is that impacted by a limit being in place or not? Now, I would argue that in most systems, including most systems in the cloud, it's pretty safe to set random page cost to something that's much lower than 4. It should still be higher than sequential page cost, and that really comes down to how the planner is written. So the planner is written under the assumption that your random page cost will be slightly higher than sequential page cost, certainly not lower, but you might want to try a low cost like 1.1. That said, just setting random page cost to 1.1 is not going to solve all issues. Sometimes your bad plans will not be caused by this, really. It's just masking the true problem, which might be a row misestimate or other problems in Postgres, like the fact that you have a limit clause and then Postgres thinks it only has to read a certain number of entries when actually it had to read a lot more unexpectedly. So always good to dive into the details on this, actually look at how these cost functions work so that you can actually understand why your query plans behave in a certain way. Thank you so much for listening. This was 5 Minutes of Postgres. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to hear about next week's episode, and talk to you next week.